Hey, welcome to Data Crunch, where we talk about big data, data science, data analytics, machine learning, and AI. Now, in our first debut of Data Crunch, we're going to talk a bit about breaking into data science, a career in data science. And today we have Dr. Lau. Now, Dr. Lau is a chief data scientist and also the founder of LEAD. So, Dr. Lau, are you ready to answer some questions?
Sure. Bring it on, Ruben.
All right, great. So today we have a few questions here that we're going to ask. These questions are written down and also asked by the students of Dr. Lau and also the comments that we found on Dr. Lau's blog. All right, so I'm going to get right into it and let's get started. So the first question that we have today here is, if I don't have any technical background, right, none whatsoever, can I venture into data science?
Okay, so this question, we get it all the time, not just from my blogs or Facebook, you know, like every time I go for a public talk also, students ask me the same thing. So actually, you don't need to have any technicals or programming background when it comes to data science. Put it this way, right? In data scientist field, usually we categorize people into data science, A-type data scientists or B-type data scientists. So A-type data scientists would be somebody more like yourself, so you're already analyzing numbers, your day-to-day job is already like looking at reports, statistics, like that. So, but B-type data scientists will be more on the builder type. So it would be someone like myself who comes from a programming background and then who slowly moves into the career path of data science. So it doesn't matter whether you have a programming knowledge or not. Everybody can learn data science and eventually become a good data scientist.
So you talk a bit about type A people and type B data scientists.
Yes.
So how do I find out if I'm a type A data scientist person or type B?
Okay, so it's not like blood test, right? So, but basically, if you have programming background, so you already know how to write programs, then you are most likely you are a type B person. So you're a builder. So for example, people who build programs, who build models, and then they fix it and they start to tweak the parameters, for example. But type A person will be somebody who are already very well versed in those analytical software like SPSS or even Excel. But they are not so used to using scripting, for example, to automate their tasks, for example, or they are less into things like databases or ETL processes. Yeah, so that would be one of the good ways to determine.
Okay, so that's to say people without technical background can actually join and venture in data science, right? But if I'm someone without any formal education, no experience, where's the best place or the best path to get started with data science?
Okay, so a lot of people, when they come to data science, they'll be like, hey, do I need the degree of that? But data science is a new field, right? Before that, it's just a concept, put it this way. And within the concept of data science, you have a lot of different things like machine learning, algebra, mathematics, and a bit of programming, a bit of data science, database skills, for example. So, and when it comes to a degree, right, is they are mostly new. So you don't really have to have a data science degree per se, but ideally, if you have a relevant degree, that'll be good enough, if you're talking about degrees. Otherwise, there are a lot of self-learned programs out there, or even like boot camps or certification that you can attend. And that will help you to get onto the right track to begin your data science career path.
Okay. So I'm really curious, right? So what are the kind of salaries that we can expect as a data scientist, whether I'm a junior data scientist, an intermediate data scientist, or maybe the senior chief level data scientist? What are the kind of salary ranges, and is it a job that is lucrative enough to go into?
You must have read the article. People tell you that, you know, data scientist is a sexist job of the 21st century, something like that, right? So let's start from the top level. So whenever people talk about chief something, not just chief data scientist, can be a CEO or CTO level. Whenever you're chief level, so you're less involved in the dirty work, so you're more involved in the management role. So you'll be working with a team, and then you manage a group of associate data scientists or junior data scientists. Like in my case, in iStream, in my own B2B companies, we have 5 to 6 data scientists for one project in the team. And yeah, then you have to manage them, and then you have different KPIs and stuff to look at. So usually at chief level, your salary will be looking at like 100 to 150,000 per year. in Malaysia, Ringgit Malaysia, right? And then if you are in Australia and US, most of the time in the local currency. And if you are looking at a more entry-level data scientist or just data analyst, usually they make a good 4,000 to 6,000 on average. Like my students who work in the corporates, the average salary is about 5,000 to 6,000.
Oh, okay. That's not too bad, huh?
Yeah.
All right. So when it comes to data science and getting, you know, getting employed, right? Won't companies actually ask for a certificate, right? Would they ask for a certificate? And if I don't have a certificate, I don't have a college degree or something like that, what then?
So usually when I mentor my students or when I train them, right, I usually make sure that they build their own portfolio. A lot of the companies, when they actually, like especially corporates, when they hire a data scientist, the HR person doesn't really know what sort of question they're expecting. So they're asking for a certificate because they have this culture, like the minimum requirements to enter our company is you need to have a degree. So it doesn't matter if you don't have a bachelor of science or bachelor of data science, for example, but look at myself, for example, right? My bachelor degree is in IT, and then I pick a major of database, and then followed by my master's, and then in PhD, I focus more on AI and machine learning. Yeah. So more importantly is whenever you attend an interview, you have to show the companies like what are the values that you can bring to the company, and you are able to do the job. Yeah, and say back to your question is like, if some of my students they apply for startup companies, most of the time the degree itself is not really that important. I wouldn't say totally not important, but less important.
So it's possible for someone without a degree to actually get a data science job?
Yes.
Okay, so we're gonna go off for a break right now. When we come back, we're gonna talk a bit about the individual characteristics of a good data scientist. See you then. Hey, welcome back to Data Crunch. Now, we're going to go right into our next question. So the next question is, what are some individual characteristics of a good data scientist, right? I'd love to see whether I can be one. So I want to know whether I'm suited to become a data scientist and what's needed in the market field out there.
Okay, I'm sure that you will be a good data scientist. You fulfill, okay, there are three criteria here. And then the number one is very good in communication. So you definitely fit this one. As data scientists, usually you need to communicate a lot with people, not just like normal communication or interpersonal skills. You need to talk to your teammate, not those kind of stuff, but you need to communicate with clients to understand their pain points, to find out where are the data, what are the things that they're looking at and how to solve their business problem. And then at the same time, you also have to do presentations and then tell a compelling stories to your stakeholders, to your audience. So the number one key skills, key characteristic of a good data scientist this is a good communication skill. And number two is open-minded. In data-driven culture companies, usually is no longer based on guts, right? Traditionally, a lot of companies, a lot of experienced executives, they can use their guts to make a lot of decisions. But as the market is moving too fast, a lot of the new decisions or the... a lot of the decisions have to be made using data-driven approach or more scientific methods. So you have to be open-minded to look at data, to think about what is this data trying to tell me, or what does this data tell us? And then from here, what are the experiments that we can do? What are the hypotheses that we can set? And things like that. So any type of feedback is good feedback. So you have to be open-minded. And then the last one, I think it will be curiosity. So be curious like a baby. Yeah, so anything that you can't just look at a graph and say, oh, this is an outlier, or this parameter is affecting the chart, so we should drop it. But whenever there's an outlier, for example, if somebody usually spend about 200 to 300 in every credit card transaction, and then one day he suddenly spend 2 to 3,000, is that a fraud transaction? Or is that something,
Right. So that means, you're talking about outliers, you're talking about, being very, so someone who is a data scientist must have good attention to detail.
Yeah, that's right. Right? So we're very curious about different things that come out. So not just thinking in a very tunnel vision, but it has to be looking at a broader picture. So be curious whenever there's something exceptional that comes out.
Miss something different, something correct. Out of the norm. Right. Okay. That is good. Now let's talk about the tools of data scientists. Right. So what are some data science tools used in the current market conditions, and what should I learn?
Okay, so you mentioned tools, right? So there are more than one. This is a very dangerous question because whenever I tell people whether you should learn Python or you should learn R, yeah, some people will be upset. It's more like chicken and egg thing, right? But I would say Python is a more suitable, more popular tool that most of the data scientists will be using. And so compared to other enterprise software, as a budding data scientist that just trying to enter the field, Python and R are both open source and free, so you can just download and use it and then try to implement all sorts of models with it. And there are a lot of scientific packages that are already implemented, frameworks are already there. So yeah, it's very easy to get on track.
Okay. All right. So we have one question here, which is a very important question. I think a lot of people will actually ask this in any situation coming to data science, breaking into data science, right? So the question is, do you have any tips, right, for interview preparation? So let's say I'm going for an interview tomorrow. What should I prepare? What would the interviewer ask me?
Okay, so I think I covered some of that in the previous question as well, is that whenever you go for an interview, the HR or the interviewer, usually they are not so clear about the job scope of a data scientist. In fact, most of the time, we data scientists, we know more about data science, and then the person that's going to hire you, they know more about their company. So I think our role here is, my advice would be, if you are going for an interview tomorrow, try to take a non-conventional approach rather than just sitting down, asking them what are the salary packages and stuff. I would prefer you to take the proactive approach to ask more questions, right? Ask them what are the business pain points that you have, what are the business questions that they are facing, how can you help them to save costs or to make more revenue, for example. And then from there, you show that by using the skill sets that you have, you can actually bring more value to the company. I think this is a much better approach rather than the traditional one.
So it's just putting out your value there so the company knows that you are a valuable individual,
yes,
and you can help the company to grow their revenues, to do all sort of things.
Yeah, correct.
Right. Now, very simple question. Any companies that you think are great for applying at? What are some companies which are suitable for a data scientist, a junior data scientist to join or to try attempting to go for?
So if you're a junior data scientist or relatively younger data scientist, I would suggest you join a startup company, at least not too new startup, but a funded startup, so that they have a lot of data for you to play with. And then, but at the same time, they don't know what to do with those data. If you are someone who is already in the middle of your career, you already know what to do, and you are looking for job stabilities, and you are comfortable within a corporate environment, then you can look at different industries like banking, insurance, transport, and also telcos. These are the industries that heavily data driven. So by joining these companies, make sure that you have enough things to do with the data. Some of the companies or some of the corporates, traditional corporates, they do have data, but the data are scattered around. So when you go in, you're doing less of a data scientist job, but you spend 80% of the time doing data gathering, crawling, cleaning, and you know those stuff.
Dirty job.
Yeah, exactly. And then before you can get to the actual meat or the actual analytical part. Yeah. So this is a bit of the observation that I found after working in a lot of companies.
Same. Well, thanks so much for your answers to these questions we have here. So what are the other questions that you have that we did not answer here today in the show, right? So let us know in the comment section below. Make sure to follow us at, subscribe to our Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube, like our Facebook, connect with us on www.thelead.io. And if you wish to connect with Dr. Lau, we have placed down the links to his LinkedIn. All his links are down there in the descriptions. And again, anything else to say, Dr. Lau?
I think we have covered quite a bit today. So if you have anything, just leave the message in the comments, and then I will see you in the next episode.
All right, see you. Thanks.